Life is a subject we all can't run away from. We live through this subject. We control what comes, what stays, and what goes in that subject. We tend to live our lives through people's eyes sometimes when we need to start living for what we feel inside, for what we know that is true, and for what we know that is right. Discover to uncover. Everything seemed so different back then from today. The world wasn't as closed up or crazy as it is now. My life all started in a place where everybody knew each other and everyone knew how to love one another. I was born in Greensboro, North Carolina on July 26, 1995. The youngest out of three and seen as the odd child in the family. My family was full of love and problems became only resistant when necessary.
Being a little kid, I would create like this imagination, like what most kids always, you know, will always do. Like when I'm playing with toys and stuff, I'll like pretend like I'm doing like a TV show or a movie, or like they're going to school, like use cards or like pencils, like action figures, stuff like that. I'll always like create this imagination that helped me, you know, feel like a kid. When I was about four, I think, I went to this daycare. It was at some lady's house, and all I did was watch TV and just play with toys. That's how I started developing this creative imagination with toys and stuff. I really didn't learn. I didn't really read like that. Being at daycare, I didn't learn math or any of that. Most of the stuff I had to go through, it made me feel robbed from my childhood. Starting like elementary school, I went to Rankin Elementary in kindergarten. I've noticed I was behind from most kids. I didn't really learn how to read, and I didn't really know how to like do math and stuff. And then my parents, they worried about me because I wasn't talking like that around the house. I wasn't being more talkative. So they took me to the specialist and they said I had a learning disability. I had a problem with oral expression and stuff, and short attention span. In school, I ended up getting held back in kindergarten. Growing up, I really didn't talk about it to much people because I felt embarrassed by that, and you know, I felt slow. One day when I was five, me and my cousin was playing around, and he wanted to play this game, like we was just going with the flow with it basically. He was just playing this game with me where like he would like play around like physical and stuff like that. And I noticed like my pants and underwear was down, and he like forced me down on the bed. And then, like, I was just noticing, like, what is he doing? And then, like, he took my pants and my underwear off. And then he started to rape me. Being that young, you don't know, like, what somebody's doing it to you. You don't know what they're doing. You don't know why they're doing it. You know, I just know at that moment, it didn't feel right to me. When that happened, no one was really around to, like, witness it. Myself, I really didn't know how to put it. I never say anything to anybody. I just know that it didn't feel right. I try to repress that moment so much. It just makes me feel like, you know, to this day, why did he do that? Another one of my relatives started sexually abusing me. He would make me do stuff to him that a woman would do to a man. There were a couple times he raped me in my room. There were times where, you know, it started to feel normal. I'm not saying, like, I enjoyed what he was doing to me, but at that moment, it just started to feel like I was starting to, like, become immune to what he was doing. So, I just couldn't understand why he was doing that. I couldn't understand anything that was going on at that time. This didn't start until I was about 7. And the abuse stopped when I was 10 years old. It happened a few times. The last time it happened, my mom left and went to the store. And he came, he raped me that day. And when my mom left, I was going to the bathroom to wash up. So he started to come in there. He threw me against the wall. And then he tried to take off my pants, my underwear. And I was just like, stop. Stop, what are you doing? Stop, stop. I started crying and I started, like, trying to push him off of me and stuff. And I was just like, what are you doing? Like, stop, what are you doing? Stop. And he started kissing on me and stuff like that. And I was just like, stop, what are you doing? And, like, at that point, I just got tired of it. I just got tired of it, and I just couldn't understand, like, why he was doing that. So he stopped and then he left the house. And a few minutes later, my mom came back, and I just started crying. Like, this don't feel right. This don't feel right no more. To me, like, it just didn't feel right. I felt so worthless that last time, and I continued to feel like that. I felt worthless for some reason. I felt like a piece of me was worthless.
Besides the things I will go through, I will keep this big smile on my face. I will do a lot of activities. at my ACES after school program. I would act in plays, dance at events, and be the weatherman for everyone. I was just a kid full of excitement and energy. People could never tell I was being hurt by others.
No one at the time was not around when all that happened. You know, it really didn't have an effect on me because I had this carefree attitude. Nothing would affect me or any of that. I would go to school, act like nothing was wrong. But at the same time, I knew something was wrong. After I left Rankin, I went to Brightwell Elementary in the first grade. I had a lot of help with my education. And I think from that point, I think I wanted to, like, my dream set was to go to college, like when I went to the school. And a lot of people helped me, you know, helped me deal with my disability, helped me with my schoolwork. And I'll go to this ACES program, this daycare at the school at Brightwood.
I was a very shy kid. I don't know how I did it, but I prepared myself to perform in front of others. When I danced or do a play, I barely looked at the audience. I would be so nervous. I always created an imagination that I'm in just a room practicing for the play or the choreography.
I started to get bullied in the second grade. Bullying, it was just verbal at that point. People would say I'm ugly, I'm gay, I look gay, I dress gay, I act gay and stuff like that. I'm just ugly. Nobody likes me, you know, I'm funny looking and stuff like that. That really brought down my self-esteem. The abuse brought it down as well. It made me feel worthless. And then the bullying, it made me feel like I'm nothing, I'm ugly. I started to believe everything people say about me. I'm gay, I'm ugly. You know, nobody likes me, you know. I didn't like how I dressed. I didn't like how I talk. People say I'm gay because, you know, when I was a kid, I had a high-pitched voice that made me sound like a female. And people would just pick on me. And I just didn't like how I represented myself. I didn't like how I looked. I didn't like how I sound. I didn't like how I dressed. And I started to, like, not feel so confident in myself. It was one time I was in the bathroom and I put soap all over my face. Like, I looked at myself in the mirror and I just kept telling myself, I'm ugly, you know. And from that point, I started to rub soap on my face. And then I grabbed one of my mom's razors. For some reason, I just, like, I cut it myself on, like, on my forehead. And I just started crying. And crying and stuff. I couldn't understand what was wrong with me. Why I felt ugly. I believed everything people said about me. The bullying, it didn't get physical until I was in fourth grade. One time at the school, I was at my ACES program, daycare, and these two dudes that were my friends at the time, we all walked in the bathroom, they just started playing around with me, because we was just playing around, like, before we started the day and stuff like that with the daycare. They just came in the bathroom, they started picking me up, you know, throwing me around and stuff like that. and I thought they were playing. So, then afterwards, they held me down on the ground, on the floor in the bathroom. And then one of them, they grabbed my head and did like that, just like did that. And like, I had a big knot on my forehead and I just started crying. So I ran out the bathroom crying and went to my like substitute ACES director, my ACES teacher, not my director, but she just rolled her eyes and looked away like she didn't want to deal with what was going on. I was just trying to tell what happened and she just looked away, rolled her eyes. So I just went to the ACES director. She did something about it. She called my mom and stuff and then she handled the situation. I almost had a concussion as well. Like, my head was hurting bad. And then I had that knot on my head. So, it could have been worse. The bullying continued on into middle school. My dad left when I was just about 4 or 5 years old. You know, I will wonder like, why is he not living here? You know, when I hang out with him, I'll be like, you know, I'll just be like sometimes, why you not living with my mom? Or like what's going on between them? There were times where I see my parents fight in front of me. There were times where, you know, I would just sense something wasn't right, but I really never paid attention to it. I was just so carefree for some reason. I really never paid attention to what was going on, but I knew in some way it had an effect on me, and I knew that something wasn't right. Around the time when I was 10, they got a divorce. You know, they were separated. Sad because like I couldn't see my dad like that again. It was like I would see my dad on and off repeatedly, and it's like, you know, it really frustrated me because I started having resentment towards my mom because I felt like she was taking my dad away from me, and I couldn't see him like that. I just didn't know what was going on. You know, he would come and visit me in school, but it's like it wasn't the same. I wanted my dad around. Me being a boy, you want your dad around. You want, like, you want somebody to look up to as a man, and I didn't have that. I felt like I couldn't have that relationship with him like that, because I felt like people were interfering with it. You know, I wanted to have that relationship with my father. I would see, like, you know, these boys and stuff, they look more fit and more masculine and stuff, and I wanted to be like that too. I started to feel insecure about how I looked. I started to feel insecure about how I dressed, because people wouldn't accept this. So it was like, you know, I was thinking, why should I accept this? Why should I accept the shoes that I wear, the clothes I have on my back? At that time, I was struggling at home with financial issues and stuff like that. I almost lost my house. It was just crazy. No one could understand what I was going through, the struggle and stuff. I would see these kids wear all these nice shoes and nice clothes and stuff, and it's like, you know, I wanted to wear that too. But at that point, I had to realize later on, I had to humble myself because, you know, I had to work. My, you know, my mom worked hard, you know, to have clothes provided for me, food provided for me, everything provided for me, because I could have been in a homeless shelter. You know, I'm in school, I'm getting my education, it shouldn't matter what, you know, what I'm wearing, what shoes I'm wearing, or, you know, how I work representing myself to other people.
Growing up from Greensboro, I was always focused on school. In my neighborhood, there were many distractions. First, my neighborhood was full of black people. Most kids I knew went to school with me or I just seen in the streets. From drug dealers, to followers, to wannabes, to seeing fights and gang-related behavior, the environment made me shield myself and not try to involve myself in any of that. As loving or messed up you can be to others, people will always find a way to point out the flaws in you. Love and support is very important. Help from others will let you know where you stand with people in your life. Hurt can damage how you think, feel, and react to certain situations. Healing is a long process where the wounds slowly vanish forever. Keep me bright, otherwise today
won't be nice. The abuse started to affect me more. I didn't love myself. I felt even more worthless. I felt so much hatred towards myself. I blamed myself for everything that was happening to me, what people would do to me, how people treated me, you know, friends at school picked on me and stuff like that. I would blame myself for that. Like, I feel like I'm to blame for that, for people doing me wrong or people treating me the way they did. So, when I was 16, that's when everything got worse. I started drinking. I started missing my curfew a lot. Me and my mom wasn't getting along. Me and my dad wasn't getting along. I started to attempt suicide a few times. There was one time I was sitting in my room with a knife that I got in the kitchen, and I was just like, you know what, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna just end it all right here. I wanted to stab that knife through my chest. Like, I just wanted to, like, end it all. I felt so worthless in this world. It's like, something is not right. I just didn't want to be here anymore. So, I was so angry at myself. I just started doing that to my wrist with the knife. I just started cutting myself. And, I would go to school the next day and show my friends what I was doing. I felt so proud about that for some reason. And then I started hanging around people who take advantage of me. At school, I would just lash out randomly, have anger outbursts and stuff like that. And then the teachers and stuff started to notice, like, maybe Donta, you need to go to anger management or something and see what's wrong with your anger. And I ignored the teacher. I was like, nah, I don't need to go to anger management or that. I didn't think nothing was wrong with me. But then, once I started to, like, cut myself and stuff, that's when I started to realize something is wrong with me. Counselors at school talked to me and stuff like that, and they was telling me how, you know, anything happened to you growing up and stuff like that. That's when I told them I was raped by my cousin. You know, they was like, have you told your mom and stuff like that? And I was just like, no, I didn't. And then they called my mom. She came to school. She got off work and came to school because she was already worried about me at that point. So I told her, and I I started crying in my arms and stuff. The counselor told my mom someone touched Donta inappropriately as a child when he was 5 years old. They took advantage of his trust and stuff like that. And I told her. I told her everything at that about that incident. I just couldn't do nothing but cry in my arms because it was just so hard to like tell her that. And she understood everything that was going on. She was just being real supportive about everything. So at that point, we started making arrangements for me to go to therapy and stuff to get the help that I needed to like get to the source of my issues and stuff with my past and stuff. At school, issues I was dealing with my friends, it caused me to be stressed. It caused me to be, you know, feel more worthless. And at that point, I was sitting in my room crying one day. And I just thought about killing myself again. I told my mom, I feel like I'm better off not in this world anymore. And she was like, Donta, you need to go in there and pray right now. The devil's just messing with you. You need to pray to God. Tomorrow's a new day. You just need to pray. Just tell God about your issues and stuff. And at that point, I just knew when I prayed that night, everything would be okay. A blessing was going to come to me. Everything would make sense, you know. At least at that point, I started to realize I had issues and I was going to get help for it. Me just saying that I need help and going to get help, God was already answering my prayers. He's helping me through a process to where I need to handle my issues. I was dealing with a lot of incidents at school that was bully related. I confronted an issue I had with my friends one day, and it got to a point where I brought a knife with me because I felt like I was going to get jumped, you know, by that group and by that group of people. So I was like, you know what? I'm tired of people thinking they can treat me any kind of way. I'm tired of people thinking they can control me, you know, hurt me physically, mentally, emotionally. So I just, if I was touched physically that day, I was going to cut them. Like, that was my goal. You touched me, I was gonna cut you. But I knew that wasn't the way to handle things, so I just walked away. That's all I could do at that point. I decided to retract my 10th grade year in high school. And my brother, he helped me with everything basically. He was real supportive, you know. He gave me good constructive criticism about what I was doing wrong, what I needed to work on with running and sprinting, because 10th grade I was a sprinter. So my first race, I came in second, but I was like the first person like at my school, you know, to be ahead of everybody else that was like on my team in that race. Everybody cheered me on, supported me and stuff, and that made me feel good about myself. It made me feel like I found a place where I belong, you know. I felt real good when it came to running, going to practices and stuff like that, because I had a chance to be around people, you know, I was doing the same thing with, you know, running. Just laugh and have fun, go to meets and stuff, just have fun, joke around and stuff like that. made me feel nervous too when I had my races and stuff like that, because growing up, I was, you know, I was shy, I'm goofy, you know, everything. I just had to realize I'm not the only one out there on the track. And other people are like running against me. They probably feel nervous and have anxiety as much as I do. The next year, my junior year, I started to run cross country, because at the end of my sophomore year, my coach recommended me to do cross country. And I was like, nah, I don't know if I can do it. But he was like, I think you would be good, you should just try it. So, you know, someone told me it's good to try some things, some new things, to see if you're good at it or not. So I decided to do that. And training and stuff over the summer, that made me feel confident enough that I can do this. You know, I had that good running ability. It's like, I can do this. I was gonna stick to it. I didn't give up on running, but you know, switching stuff around, trying something new, it made me feel like, you know what? Let me knock this out. So, after everything, I started to write poetry at that time too. I was sitting in my room just writing poems about everything I was dealing with, all the anger I had inside, all the hurt I had inside. I started writing it down on this piece of paper. And as I read it, it's like, I was like, you know, I was like, damn, I didn't know I had this much creativity in me. And then I just didn't know, like, where did I get this from? I knew I had that ability to write. I just really never was interested in it like that. Because I would write like song lyrics and stuff like that, but I didn't know I had that much ability to do that. I had all the creativity. I had the ability to write anything that comes to my mind. So it's like, you know, like, wow, I have the ability to write poetry. So that year, my junior year, I was on the cross country team. You know, I started reading my poems to everybody. I was trying to grow up my shyness by doing that, reading my poems in front of people. We had this talent show at my high school one day, and I came in third place because a lot of people, the audience was crying, a lot of people was cheering me on, a lot of people were saying my poems were deep and stuff. My family was there, my mom, my brother, my sister. Everybody was just like, you know, Donta, you did real good, your poetry is real good, you know. And I was just surprised that I came in third place. I was like, wow, I didn't know I had that talent. Me realizing I had that talent made me feel like I was worth something. Running cross country made me feel like I was worth something, because I had people who supported me. I had people who know that I have a place in this earth.
Talents was the only way to help me escape from what was going on. Running made me feel like I was on a trail to success where no one can stop me. Writing poems or mentoring people with my life stories helps me feel like I have a purpose. Maya Angelou and Langston Hughes became an inspiration to me as I started to write poems. Their words moved me. It touched my heart as if I was writing the same thing. Tyler Perry inspires me to do film and artwork, to bring real life situations to reality. Speaking up upon things that other people are afraid to speak on.
Skinny and stuff like that. So I felt like, you know, my body looks and stuff like that, I felt, you know, insecure about that. And I think my senior year in high school, that's when I realized I really love myself. I love who I am as a human being. You know, I'm winning all these awards and stuff in high school. A lot of people are telling me, like, I'm an inspiration to them. Like, I would go up there, like, during these events and stuff in high school, I was, like, reading, like, writing poetry about what I was going through in my life. People will cry in the audience, like, when they hear my story. People will say, like, you are a real inspiration. You have courage to actually go up there. You being this young, you have enough courage to go up there and talk about things that other people wouldn't feel comfortable talking about, or other people wouldn't feel comfortable expressing and how they feel and stuff. Just graduating high school, that made me feel more optimistic and happy about my future. My family was there to support me. It just mattered to me at that point, you know, as long as I have the love and support from people in my family that are actually there for me, that's all that matters. As long as they see me doing what I'm supposed to do, or they see me doing something that is helping me, is helping, you know, helping me benefit myself, that's all that matters. My dad, my mom, my brother, my sister, my grandma, everybody in my family. I struggled real hard to get to the school that I wanted to get to going to college. And then I found Louisburg College. So, at that point, Louisburg College, it was a 2-year school, and I was, you know, determined to get, like, my first degree in school and just transferred to a 4-year after I was done with 2 years at that school. So I was like, you know what? I'm just take this chance. Regardless of what happens, as long as I'm getting my education, I'm good. Going to college, I was homesick. I didn't know anybody at the school. I stayed in my room most of the time. I tried to be involved a little bit as possible, but I didn't want to, like, overdo myself. Because I still had to focus on my studies. I didn't know how to balance activities at school and then balance my schoolwork. So basically, I decided to do running club. All this other stuff I was doing at school, you know, I just decided to be involved a little bit. I realized at that point I still haven't dealt with the emotional part of my sexual abuse. It caused me with my sexuality at that time. It caused me to be more, it caused me to enter this environment again where I was being taken advantage of, controlled, hurt mentally, physically and stuff. I was like, okay, something is not right. I'm continuing to deal with this trend again. Something is not right. So I started to realize that the reason why all of that stuff was going on, because I still haven't dealt with it. I haven't told the full truth of what happened to me when I was a little kid. I kept that hidden for so long because I was in fear it was going to break my family apart. I was in fear of a lot of things. And at that point, I realized I can't let people control how I interact with other people. I can't let that person that did that to me, my relative that did that to me, I can't let that control how I interact with other people. I can't let that control my life. I can't let the people that were hurting me control how I live my life. I had to take that control back from the abuse. I had to take that control back. I had to stop living in fear and start being more expressive. of times about growing up, being sensitive, having a good heart and stuff like that. People would take advantage of that, or people wouldn't like that. You know, most boys wouldn't like the fact that I was sensitive. Like, you know, I would show my emotions and stuff like that. But, I mean, that's just who I am as a person. So, I dealt with that as well. You know, it's just I have to learn people. I just have to realize a lot of people are not going to accept that. They can't accept that then. They just don't love me or, you know, can't accept me as a person. So, at that point, I realized, analyzed my issues, and just realized that I need to start being able to just put forth my truth so I can just feel better about myself and happy about myself. This past summer, I did like a challenge, a self-growth challenge on myself to see what issues I needed to deal with within myself in order to take that control back that I have in my life. I have no right to judge anybody. I have no right to bring somebody down just because I'm down. You never know what a person is going through every day. I don't want anybody to judge me or point out my flaws because I know how that feels growing up, you know? So I feel like it's right to accept other people for who they are, you know, whether they're gay, bi, straight, they have a mental disorder, a mental disability, a learning disability, or a mentally challenged. It's all about accepting them and working with them and understanding. And you can build that connection with them because it's not hard. It's all about accepting what life is, growing from it, the reality of it. It's all about being who you are and letting others be who they are as well.
The discovering to realizing who I am inside. It's hard to accept a feeling you have inside of yourself. We all want that acceptance and understanding from others. But the understanding and acceptance starts with you. I may not want to believe the reality of things sometimes, but if I want to continue to live a happy life, I have to accept the truth, understand it, and move forward with it. Man, life is so unpredictable, but as humans, we have the power to grow and be in control. Not only I wanted to tell my story, I want people to be inspired by it. I can't give you anything but the reality of my life. Being this young, I want to explore my dreams. I want to make things I see in my head come true. This project gives you an idea of what I saw in my head. My words give you a feel of what I'm feeling inside. My story gives you the chance to be inspired to tell the truth in order to live the truth. I want to uncover things to discover who I am as a human being. I want to discover to uncover.
my fear that you'll be gone for good, so now hold on like leaves and fall to what is left. Said a father left a younger. He said he'll be back with that same tone that you just said you'll stay forever with. It seems that all the autumn leaves are falling. I feel like you're the only reason for it. All the things you do, all the things you do, all the things you do. All the things you do, all the things you do, all the things you do. It seems that you're the only reason for it. I've been bleeding in your silence. I feel safer in your violence. I hold on like leaves and fall to what is left. Before I sleep, I talk to God. He must be mad with me. It's karma. I'm confused who I'll spend my forever with. It seems that all the autumn leaves are falling. I feel like you're the only reason for it. All the things you do, all the things you do, all the things you do. All the things you do, all the things you do, all the things you do.